Good afternoon, everybody. Started to be. So today we'll be learning antiprotozoal age. So today we'll be learning this topic is antiprotozoal age. Okay. So what are protozoans? They are eukaryotes and unicellular organisms. Most of the protozoal infections are due to unhygienic conditions. Because of your unhygienic conditions, we are infected by this protozoal infections because of your unhygienic conditions. Less treated than the bacterial infection. Less treated than your bacterial infections and antiprotozoal drugs are also more toxic because they have got much more similarity to your host mechanism. That's why they are less likely to be treated than a bacterial infection and they are more toxic. Protozoal infection can be one or more infection results from following organisms. It might be caused due to amoebiasis, trypanosomiasis, giardiasis, leishmaniasis, trichomoniasis, malaria, and toxoplasmosis. So these are the various causes of your protozoal infections. These are the various causes of your protozoal infections. So now let's see one by one. So protozoal infections. What are the protozoal infections? What are the major infections of your where do they? So in case of amoebiasis, they infect the intestine. Malaria, it is mosquito-borne infection. This is caused by Plasmodium vivax or malaria species. Giardiasis is an infection of your small intestine. So it causes the intestine of your small intestine. Leishmaniasis is disease spread by the bite of female sandworm. So leishmaniasis is the disease spread by the bite of female sandworm. Toxoplasmosis is nothing but the infection due to parasite toxoplasm. Okay, and trypanosomiasis is then the infection. Several diseases in your caused by parasite protozoa. Trypanosomes. Okay, these are the various infections, protozoal infections. And where do they? Now, leishmaniasis. What is leishmaniasis? It is transmitted to the humans by female infected flies by biting pre infected cats, dogs, and rodents. So, they come from the major source is your diet, the pre infected cats, dogs, and rodents. And the female flies, they are transmitted to human through this flies. Visceral leishmaniasis is caused by Leishmaniasis donovani. They invade the reticuloendothelial cells, results in enlargement of their liver, spleen, lymph nodes. And the drug of choice is sodium stibogluconate. Okay. Cutaneous leishmaniasis caused by Leishmaniasis brasiliensis involves ulcerations of your skins and lesions. So there will be an ulceration in your skins and there will be lesions in the skin. American leishmaniasis is caused by Leishmania tropica, characterized by ulceration of your mucous membrane or the membrane of the mouth, nose, and throat. So this is mostly an upper respiratory tract caused by American leishmaniasis. The drug of choice for this type of leishmaniasis is antiammonical. So antimony containing drugs are used in the treatment of leishmaniasis. Okay. So, trypanosomiasis. So, they are transmitted to humans from insects infected by protozoa Trypanosoma brucei. Types are African trypanosomosis caused by Glossina species. Leading to sleeping sickness associated with fever, headache, drowsiness, lymph enlargement, These pathogens enter the scene is called as mental disturbance. Okay, so I was explaining yesterday when I was teaching one of the drugs for the child, that is Soramin. Okay, American trypanosomosis. Okay, they are caused by trypanosis cruzi. These are the causative. No, giardiasis. Yeah, are found in animals and human feces. They are found in animal and human. They also thrive in contaminated food, water, and salt. The symptoms of giardiasis generally show up 1 or more 2 weeks before the after the exposure. So once it gets exposed, when the patient gets exposed to this infection, after 2 or more weeks, the symptoms occur like fatigue, nausea, diarrhea, greasy stool, loss of appetite, vomiting, bloating in your stomach, abdominal cramps, weight loss, excessive gas, headache, and abdominal pain. Treatment is metronidazole, paracetamol, and tinidazole. These are the primary treatment for your giardiasis. Trichomoniasis. Okay, they are sexually transmitted, causing in male. In males, it causes urethritis, and in female, it causes vaginitis. Okay. And if the and in this case, if one partner is infected, it is mandatory for the other partner to also undergo treatment because it is trans. It can also be transmitted to the other partner. Balanidiasis is caused by Balanidiasis colibri. It produces diarrhea similar to that of your amoebiasis. So these are the various type of protozoal infections that occur to human beings. Okay. Now what are protozoal infections? These protozoal infections are difficult to treat than your bacterial infection. As I said before, they are difficult to treat than the bacterial infection because this protozoal cells, that is, you can have metabolic process closer to your human host than your prokaryotic bacterial pathogens. So they have got the metabolism process which is similar to that. So if you try to attack this your protozoal cells, even your host cells gets damaged. So many of the antiviral drug causes toxic effects to the on the host also. And antivirals are not safe during your pregnancy. So care should be taken when you are prescribed with your and this causes teratogenicity or toxicity. Okay. So you have to be very careful when you are taking all these antiprotozoal drugs during pregnancy, lactation and all. So now let's go for amoebiasis. So we'll be telling a bit more details about amoebiasis. So what is amoebiasis? This is a 2-mark question that is asked in your exam along with the examples of the drug. So amoebiasis is a protozoal infection of the intestinal tract that occurs due to ingestion of the food and water contaminated with Entamoeba histolytica cysts. So what is amoebiasis? Amoebiasis is a protozoal infection of the intestinal tract that occurs due to ingestion of food and water contaminated with your Entamoeba histolytica cysts. So you are infected food and water with Entamoeba histolytica cysts. If they are getting contaminated with particular with this microorganism, this leads to your amoebiasis. This leads to your amoebiasis. So what is the basic life cycle of your this type of protozoa? So first is cyst. The human get infected by the cyst, ingestion of your cyst. This cyst leads, second step is this cyst when it goes through the intestine and enters the intestinal walls and all, they get transformed into your tropozoids. And these tropozoids then penetrate into your intestinal walls, multiply, this leads then followed by multiplication of tropozoids within the colon wall and then systemic invasion. From there, they through your portal system, it infects your other systemic organs like your liver and other parts of your body. Cyst formation in the rectum, and then so once it goes into your rectum from the colon, when it goes to your rectum, because of lack of water, they again get converted into your, and they are excreted in the feces to infect other human. So this is the life cycle, basic life cycle of your entomological histolytica. So if you can see, you ingest your cyst, then it goes into your stomach. The cyst is a protective coating around this microorganism. So once then this leads to the formation of your troposer. So when they enter the intestine, so they get converted into your troposer. And within the intestine, this cyst breaks open and liberates your troposer, which then infects the colon wall and multiply over there. And this then spread to your systemic invasion. It leads to your systemic invasion. And then once it enters your colon, again it gets cyst. There is a cyst formation, and they are expelled in the cyst form in the this. So this is your basic life cycle of your protozoan, amoebic, entomoebic, histolytica. So how they enter, how they develop and spread in the human body. Okay. So as I said, there is a cyst phase, which is the infective phase, which causes the infection. They can survive outside the human body and transform into your troposome. So the cyst is responsible for your infection. And troposome, they are non-infective, invasive phase. So they can reproduce. This troposome can reproduce. And they may feed on the intestinal bacteria or invade or ulcerate the walls of large intestine. And they also can migrate into your liver and other tissues through your portal veins and cause acute amoebic hepatitis. It leads to your acute amoebic hepatitis. They later then transform to your cyst, and they are excreted in the feces. So this is your basic life cycle, as I was explaining. This is how it enters from your portal system to your liver and then infects your liver. So from your intestine through your portal vein, they infect your liver. Okay, and this leads to hepatic amoebiasis. Okay, so mode of transmission as contaminated food, drink. So here the man is the host. Cyst of entamoeba histolytica resist the acidity, because of the cyst, they resist the acidity of the sun, and they develop into your troposites in your gut, that is your small intestine, and causing invasive disease in the distal GIT tract. The troposites again get converted into your cyst, probably due to decreased water content. So due to the decreased water, and they again form a protective layer around themselves, and they are excreted in the cyst. Troposites cannot survive in adverse conditions, but cysts are able to tolerate such. So they can only survive the extreme condition only when it is in cyst form, not when it is in the troposites. So troposites, that's why are only formed in your human GI tract, not outside. Outside it exists as in a cyst form with a protective layer around the structure. Okay. So there are clinical presentations, how they occur. There are asymptomatic intestinal infection, acute dysentery, carrier or passing cyst. Mild to moderate intestinal disease, they cause non-dysentric colitis, that is your inflammation in your colon. Severe intestinal infection, dysentery, and hepatic abscess, abnoma. This is localized lesions in your colon and other extra intestinal disease. This is known as systemic. This is known as systemic amoebiasis. This is known as systemic amoebiasis. So these are various presentation classification of your different types of amoeba according to the severity of the disease. So now the drugs which are used for the treatment of amoebic, that is anti-amoebic. So the drugs for treatment of anti-amoebic histolytica. So They are classified into tissue amoebocytes, which infect for the two. So in case of tissue amoebocyte, which affect on both intestinal and extra-intestinal amoebiasis, example are nitroimidazole derivatives like metronidazole, tinidazole, and ornidazole, along with alkaloids that is emitting and dehydroemitting. It is emitting and dehydroemitting. For extra-intestinal amoebiasis, extra-intestinal amoebiasis means not inside the intestinal lumen, outside, like in the liver abscess and all. So, chloroquine is used. Okay. So, and luminal amoebocyte means which shows its effect on the lumen of intestinal lumen. So, such type of drugs are dialoxinate, furate, nitazolinide, heterodoxyquinoline like iodoquinol and chloroquinol. Antibiotics like your tetracycline and paracetamol. So these are some of the classes of anti-amoebic drug which has to be mentioned when they ask you what is amoebic dysentery or amoebiasis. Give the classification of your anti-amoebic. So all these things have to be included in your answer. So there are, as I mentioned, there are of three classes: luminal amoebocyte, tissue amoebocyte, or systemic amoebocyte, followed and mixed amoebocytes. Because it depends upon the site of action of the drugs, anti-amoebic drugs. So now, what is luminal anti-amoebocyte? So what is luminal? So they act on the parasite in the lumen of the body. So they act of your lumen of the intestine. They're used for the treatment of asymptomatic amoebiasis. They include halogenated 8-hydroxyquinoline that like iodoquine and chloroquine. Also dichloroacetamide derivatives like your dialoxinate furate derivative, and also argon arsenals like carbazone and milarsone. Okay, so these are the class which are used in the as a luminal amoebocyte, means which attacks on your tropozoites which are present in the lumen, okay. And antibiotics like paracetamol, tetracycline, and erythromycin. So these are some of the classifications of the drugs which are known as luminal amoebocyte. Now tissue amoebocyte, or they act on intestinal walls or and liver or any other extra intestinal tissue. So this place where it acts is on the intestinal wall. So in intestinal wall, what are present? Basically the tropozoids are, so they are active against your tropozoid. They are usually used for the treatment of systemic form of the disease, that is intestinal walls and liver abscess. Okay, so they are basically used for the treatment of tropozoid. They include nitroimidazole like metronidazole, tinidazole, and secnidazole and ornidazole. Alkaloids like emetine and dehydroemitting. And also chloroquine like antimalarial. So they are used for the treatment of tissue amoebocytes. Okay. Now mixed amoebocytes. They are effective against both luminal as well as systemic form of blood. But although this luminal concentration is too low for single drug. Therefore, they are always given in combination. Example, metronidazole and tinidazole. They are always given in combination with other amoebocytes. They are always given in combination with other So this is mixed amoebocyte. Metronidazole and tinidazole are the examples. So now let's come for the first class of drug, that is dialoxinate furate. First class of drug is an dialoxinate furate. Okay. So we're drawing a structure on the board. So dialoxinate furate is an example of dichloroacetamide derivative. It is an example of dichloroacetamide acetamide. If you draw the structure of this, it is first, it is a dichloroacetamide, CH3N. It is an example of dichloroacetamide, and it is N-methylated over here, which is connected to an phenyl ring containing an O, forms an ester with the furfural 2 furfuric acid. So it forms an ester with a furfuric acid. So dioxygenate forms an uret, is nothing but a combination of your dichloroacetamide derivative with your dioxygenate with your furoic acid. So this is the structure of your thing. So it is at the para position, there is an O, and it is an N-methylated acid dichloroacetamide derivative. Okay. This is connected to your furoic acid. Okay, that furoic is nothing but furan with the carboxylic acid at the second position, which forms an ester with your phenolic group of your dioxygenate. Okay, this is the structure of your dioxygenate furoate. Okay, this, so the mechanism of action of this drug is they inhibit the protein synthesis, they inhibit the protein synthesis and activity of some of the protozoal enzymes. So they inhibit the protein synthesis and activity some of the protozoal enzymes. They are used in cyst form during cyst forming patients. So whenever there is a cyst, that is in the cyst form, they are active against the cyst forming patients. Treatment for your extra intestinal and also for the treatment of extra intestinal amebiasis. They are also used for the treatment of extra intestinal amebiasis. Okay. Given orally, split in the intestine mostly into dioxygenate and is absorbed and conjugated to form glucuronide, which is excreted through the urine. The unabsorbed moiety is being amebocidal agent also. It is around 10%. So even that shows your amebocidal activity. It's a drug of choice for your asymptomatic intestinal, that is luminal amebocide. It's an example for luminal amebocide. They are, and for eradication along with all forms of amebiasis. So they can be used, but they are not active against troposide. So it is only active against the cyst form of your, in the cyst form of your protozoal, anti-amebic histolytic, not active against your troposide. Dosage is around 500 mg, 3 times a day for 10 days. Adverse effects are vomiting, abdominal cramps, flatulence, diarrhea, and paralysis. Okay, these are the side effects. Contraindicated in patients, pregnancy, children under the age of 2. So next example is your halogenated hydroxyquinoline. So next example is halogenated hydroxy, 8-hydroxy. So what is this 8-hydroxyquinoline? First you should draw a quinoline and an hydroxy group at the 8th position. 1, nitrogen is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now in case of clioquinoline, it contains a chloro at the 5th position and a iodo at the 7th position. This is the example of clioquinoline. And in case of iodoquinoline, the chlorine at the 5th position is replaced by your iodine. So chlorine at the 5th position is replaced by the iodine. This is the example of iodoquinoline. This is an example of iodoquinoline. So what is the mechanism of action of this drugs? What is the mechanism of action of this? Okay. So they form chelation with the ferrous ion, which is essential for protozoal metal. So they form a complex with the metal, ferrous ions, which is necessary for your metabolism in your protozoa. So they inhibit your protozoal metabolism. Okay, this is the mechanism of action of your cleocline and iodocline. The adverse effect include iodine toxicity, thyroid enlargement, and skin allergic reactions. These are the side effects of this particular class of drug. Okay, so examples of halogenated hydroquinones are cleocline and iodocline. So these are your 8 hydroxy quinoline derivative. They are effective against organism in GIT only, not intestinal walls of your and your liver. So they are not effective in case on your intestinal walls or the liver. They are used as luminal amebocyte. Only in the luminal cavity they show the activity. They do not have any effect on the walls of the intestine as well as your liver cells. Okay, for eradication of infection given along with tissue amoeba. So that's why they are always given in combination with other drugs which can penetrate into your cell walls. They are given in combination with your metronidazole and all. They are inactive against trochoside in your intestinal wall and extraintestinal system. They are inactive against the trochoides in the intestinal walls and the extra intestinal tissue. The side effects are anorexia, rexia, headache, and rash and pertussis. Discontinue if observed persistent iodine toxicity. Okay. Now comes your next class of drug, organoarsenics, means arsenic acid containing drugs. Arsenic acid containing. The first class of drug is carbazole. What is carbazole? The structure is quite simple to be remembered. It is an arsenic. Instead of your benzoic acid, it contains an arsenic acid. Okay? So you just draw an arsenic acid. OH. So this is arsenic acid which contains an urea at the para position, which contains an urea at the para positions. NH2C double bond O NH. This is an urea linkage which is at the para position of your arsenic acid. So this is the structure of carbazole. The carbazole is an organoarsenic compound. It is an example of organoarsenic compound used for the treatment of chronic luminal amebiasis. Used for the treatment of chronic luminal amebiasis. They act by interacting by inactivating enzyme containing sulfhydryl. So the enzymes which are present in your protozoan, which contain sulfhydryl, they form a complex with that and thus inactivating the protozoan. They are least favored because of your toxicity, because it can infect also the enzymes which are present in humans containing sulfhydryl. So that's why they are toxic with the human. So they are not much used. Okay, they are example of luminal amebocyte. The mechanism of action is by inactivating the enzymes which contain your sulfhydryl groups in the protozoan cells. Okay. Now next example is melasoprol. Next example is melasoprol. So it is also a derivative of arsenic. It is also a derivative of arsenic. It's also derivative of arsenic. So what does the basic structure contain? Similar to that of, instead of your arsenic acid, it contains a dithiol cyclic linkage. So draw a thing, then you draw an arsenic AS which is connected to sulfur and H. So this is your right hand side, then this is connected to your at the para position to your amine, which is connected to a triazine, which is connected to a triazine. If you see a triazine, diamino triazine moiety, which is connected to a diamino triazine moiety. This is the structure of your melasoprol. Okay, this is the structure of your melasoprol. They similar to that of your arsenic carbazole. They also bind to the sulfhydryl groups of your proteins, thus affecting the cellular structure and functions of various selective troposomal enzymes like phosphofructokinases and reductases. Okay, they're used for the treatment of African trypanosomiasis. They are also used typically for trypicidal activity. They are used for the trypicidal activity. They are restricted because of the toxin. Their use is restricted because of the toxin. Because any arsenic containing compound, they cause metal toxicity in your human host cells. That body. That's why they are restricted in the use. They have got good CNS penetrance, so can be used in the treatment of meningoencephalitis. That's what they're used in the meningoencephalitis. Okay. The side effects are rashes, fever, proteinuria, vomiting, and abdominal. So, what is the structure of milnacipran? So, it contains an diaminotriazine group, which is connected to an 4-amino arsenic dithiol containing linkage. Okay. That is your structure of your milnacipran. So now let's go for the next drug. Metronidazole is very commonly used drug for your anti-protozoa treatment. And it is a frequently asked question in your exam. And it is frequently asked question in your exam, right? The structure and synthesis and mechanism of action of your metronidazole, ornidazole, or tinidazole. Okay, depending upon all the things I've got said. So it is a nitroimidazole derivative. It is a nitro. What is imidazole? 1,3-diazole. So it contains a nitro in between the two nitrogens, a methyl, and the saturated nitrogen is connected to an ethanol group. Your saturated nitrogen is connected to your saturated nitrogen is connected to ethanol group. Next to that, it is a nitro and a methyl. And the third, in between the two nitrogen, it is the methyl, and the nitro is adjust at the fifth position. 1, 2, second position methyl, third position nitrogen, fourth position empty, and fifth position is the nitro substitution. So this is an example of nitroimidazole derivative. Example, metronidazole. Why metro, methyl, nitro, and imidazole? That's why it is called metronidazole. Okay, the nitro group of your metronidazole, it is reduced by protozoal, leading to your cytotoxic reduced product which binds to your DNA and proteins, resulting in your parasite. They are used as mixed amebocide. They are the drug of choice for intestinal and extra-intestinal amebiasis. They act on troposites also. So most of your previous drugs, they didn't act on your troposite, but metronidazole act on your, but they don't have any effect on your cyst. They can be used for your systemic and extra used in your systemic infection as well as tissue infections. Okay. So now let's go further. As I mentioned, so metronidazole is a prodrug, and when I mentioned. They are prodrug. So it is converted in an anaerobic organism by a redox enzyme called pyruvate peroxidin oxidoreductase enzyme, which converts your nitro group metronidazole into your chemically reduced form by ferroxidin or a ferroxidin linked metabolic process. And it's when it gets converted into your amino group, this gets incorporated into your DNA. This leads to your DNA fragmentation and inhibition of your nucleic acid synthesis. This leads to the death of your protozoa. So this is your mechanism of action of your metronidazole. They are pharmacokinetics. They are metabolized by oxidation in liver by mixed function oxidation followed by glucuronidation. And they are excreted in urine as unchanged drug plus your metabolite. clearance is difficult in case of liver impact. Uses, they are used in as an anti-ankylosing and troposcet, but not cyst. So they are active against your troposcets, not against the cyst. They are used for treatment of all tissue infections with antihistolytic infection, not effective against intraluminal parasites. So within the lumen parasite, they are not, because it is in cyst form. So they are not effective in case of intraluminal parasites. So they must be always given in combination with your luminal amebocyte to ensure eradication of the infection. That's why they are all mostly given along with the combination of dialoxinate, furate, paromycin, due to the rapid absorption from the GIT. They are also used as anti-trichomoniasis. It is also used as anti-anaerobic bacteria and also treatment of giardiasis, which is also a type of which also causes dysentery. Okay. Adverse effect, they cause nausea, vomiting, dry mouth, metallic taste in the mouth, infrequent vomiting, diarrhea, rashes, insomnia, and neutropenia. Rare case to say, there are severe central nerves, well, toxic, that ataxia, encephalopathy, seizures. Drug withdrawals has a disulfide-like effect. So nausea and can occur in if alcohol is ingested during the therapy. So you should avoid metronidazole and all if you consume alcohol. So when you are taking this metronidazole, you should not take alcohol. It potential anticoagulant property of your cumarin. It accelerates elimination of phenytoin and phenobarbitals. Therefore, and it should be avoided during pregnancy. And also, as it is seen to show teratogenic effect. What is teratogenic? Means deformity in your childbirth. So this will lead to abnormality in childbirth. So this metronidazole and tinidazole and all should not be prescribed during your pregnancy. So the synthesis of your metronidazole. Important question asked in your exam frequently. Okay, asked in your exam frequently. So what is the first one? You see 1-ethane or ethylene diamine or ethane 1,2-diamine. So ethylene diamine, that is your ethylene diamine, you treat it with acetonitrile in presence of zinc. It undergoes cyclization to give you your 2-methyl-1-H imidazole. This is followed by nitration using phosphorus pentoxide and nitric acid. So you get your nitration. And then you treat with chloroethanol, you get your corresponding metronidazole. So this is the synthesis of your metronidazole. Very important from your examination point of view. Frequently asked question. Write the mechanism of actions, structure, and synthesis of your metronidazole. It comes for 5 marks along with classify amoebic, anti-amoebic agents. So this is the question that is asked in your exam. Other structures are tinidazole and ornidazole. What you see in both the structure? So it contains in case of metronidazole, it is an ethanol ring group is linked. Whereas in case of tinidazole, the chain length contains your ethyl sulfonated group. Okay, SO2 group. Instead of your OH, it is an ethyl sulfonate group. Whereas in case of metronidazole, it is an OH. This is replaced by ethyl sulfonate. Whereas in case of ornidazole, okay, it contains ethanol group is there, but it is also linked to an methyl chloride, that is CH2Cl group. Okay, that is the difference between your ornidazole, tinidazole, and your metronidazole. Okay, tinidazole contains an ethyl sulfonate group, whereas your ornidazole contains an extra branch CH2Cl group, that is methylene chloride group. Okay, so this is your structures of your tinidazole, ornidazole. These are asked in your exam for 2 marks or along as a 5 marks question. They are effective in treatment of amoebiasis, giardiasis, and trichomoniasis, and effective against vaginal trichomoniasis. The mechanism of action is similar to that of your metrin. So it gets converted, your nitro gets converted to your amino group, which gets incorporated into your DNA, just leading to your DNA fragmentation of your protozoan cells. Now comes your emitting and dehydrating. So what you see, emitting structure. So it is an example of an tetrahydroisoquinoline. So it contains a dimethoxy tetrahydroquinoline. But if you see, basically it is a dimethoxy tetrahydroisoquinoline. Okay. Now this is then connected to a six-membered saturated ring, which contains an ethyl group, and which is connected to another dimethoxy isoquinoline moiety by a methylene group, okay, which is connected to another molecule of tetrahydroisoquinoline, which is connected to another molecule, dimethoxy tetrahydroisoquinoline, by a methylene group, which you can see. Okay, so what all things it contains? It contains a dimethoxy tetrahydroisoquinoline, which is fused with another six-membered piperidine ring, okay, and which is connected to another dimethoxy tetraquinoline, dimethoxy isoquinoline moiety by a methylene group. So this is the structure of emitting. And what is the other example? It is dehydro. So there is a double bond at the point of over here. Next to your ethyl substitution, there is a double bond. So that is why it is called dehydro. There is a loss of hydrogen moiety. So that's lead to formation of dehydroemitin. This is a synthetic analog of your emitin, which is more effective than that of your emitin. So now let's go for the, so the structure, I think you might have understood. It is an example of dimethoxy tetrahydroquinoline, isoquinoline moiety, which then gets fused with your, forms a piperidine moiety, which contains an ethyl group. This is connected to another dimethoxy isoquinoline by a methylene group, that is CH2 group. So this is the structure of emitin. Now let's go for the explanation. So it is obtained from, it's a plant alkaloid which is obtained from ipecacuanha. Okay, and its synthetic analog is dehydroemitin. So and dehydroemitin is synthetically produced an antiproduct similar to that of emitin, and in its anti-amoebic property and structure, but they differ only in the presence of double bond next to your ethylene, but it produces less side effect. So only difference between your emitin and dehydroemitin is it contains a double bond which is next to your ethyl group, and it has got fewer side effect as compared to that of your iso as compared to that of emitting. So what is mechanism? They attack the tropozole by causing irreversible block of protein synthesis. They form an irreversible complex with your inhibitor protein synthesis in your protozoan cells. They are usually given as IM or subcutaneous, but never given orally or intravenous. So it is always given intramuscular or subcutaneous. Clinical use, it is used in amoebic liver abscess or balanitis, and it is also used for intestinal wall infection. Also, if there is an infection in the intestinal walls, also this emitin or dehydroemitin can be prescribed, and also in case of severe amoebiasis, that is acute amoebic dysentery, this can be given because of your better penetration. Dehydroemitin along with antibiotics are preferably due to less toxicity. So they are always given along with antibiotics for the treatment of severe amebiasis. It works even. Then amitin, they cause pain at the site of inhalation. They cause nausea, vomiting and diarrhea, neuromuscular weakness, serious toxic like cardiotoxic, cardiac arrhythmias, hypotension and congestive heart failure, which is associated with their amitin. That's why its use is very limited only in case of severe infection, protozoan infections. This drug is prescribed. Now, the next example is eflornithine. So what is this eflornithine? If you see the structure, it is similar to your ornithine, which is an essential amino acid. It has got similar structure, similar to that of ornithine. Only thing is that it has an difluoromethyl group at the second position of your ornithine group. So if you see that structure between ornithine and your eflornithine, they have an CF3, CF2, that is difluoromethylene methyl group at the second position. It is an example of diamino. It's an example of diamino or negatively charged this thing. Amino acids. So it is used for using the treatment of trypanosidal agent. Okay, it is used as trypanosidal agent and also used as an important for removing the excessive hair growth in faces of the people, women. Basically, it is used for its cosmetic appeal for removal of excess of hair from the woman's faces. Okay, it has role as tryponicidal aid drug. It is nothing but an fluoramino acid derivatives and an alpha amino acid. Okay, it is derived from ornithine, which is also an amino acid, as I explained. So used for the treatment of African trypanosomiasis, that is sleeping sickness, and also excessive hair growth on the face of the female. So it is used also as hair removal. Also, mechanism of action, they act as a suicide inhibitor by irreversibly binding with ornithine decarboxylase enzyme and preventing the natural substrate ornithine from accessing the active site. So instead of ornithine getting binded to your ornithine decarboxylase, this gets incorporated into that particular enzyme, and thus this enzyme ornithine catalyzes the decarboxylation of ornithine, a product of urea, that is energy metabolism, to form pertussis. This reaction is committed step in polyamine synthesis. So this is a very important step in your polyamine synthesis. Now, what are these polyamines? Polyamines are polycations that interact with the negatively charged molecules such as DNA, RNA, and proteins. And they play an important role in your cell growth, survival, and your proliferation. So this polyamines, if it is blocked, this will inhibit your cell growth, survival, and proliferation. And changes in polyamine level has been associated with aging and disease, various other diseases. So this leads to your cell death. So this is the example is eflornithine. So how do you remember the structure? So you remember the structure of ornithine alpha. It is an amino acid which is linked by how many carbon it has? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, four carbon CH2. Okay, and connected to a carboxylic acid and an amino acid, and it contains a diamine. So if you see at the alpha position of your ornithine, it contains a CF2 group. So this is the structure of eflornithine. This is the structure of eflornithine. team. Hello. This is structure of F-fluoro. Now next is chloroquine. Okay. So next example is chloroquine. So chloroquine, if you heard, it is also used for the treatment of malaria. And as you know that it's more concentration in the liver. So extra-intestinal infection for the treatment of extra-intestinal amebosis, this chloroquine can be used in combination with other drugs like metronidazole, which is a luminal amebosis, for the treatment of amoebic liver abscess. Okay, diseases. So this can be used for the treatment of amoebic liver diseases. So because chloroquine has got more concentration in your liver cells. Okay, that's why chloroquine can be used in the treatment of your as an antiprotozoal. Okay. Now the next is atovaquinone. So atovaquinone. So this is also an example of anti-malaria. This is also an example of anti-malaria. And if you'd have studied in your anti-malaria classes, so it contains naphthoquinone. It contains a naphthoquinone ring, which is connected by a cycloxyl to an chlorobenzene. It contains a chlorobenzene ring. So if you look at the structure, first it is a naphthoquinone, that is carbonyl group at 1 and 4 position and a double bond in between, which is connected to an cyclohexyl ring and which is in turn connected to an chlorobenzene, which is connected to a chlor. So this is the structure of your atovaquinone. Okay, and now the mechanism of action and atovaquinone. What is this? So basically the protozoal requires energy from the mitochondria. So this protozoal, the energy source is mitochondria. So atovaquinone, what does that? It selectively inhibits the mitochondrial electron transport mechanism, which is your energy producing agent, from where you produce the energy. So this, once there is no energy, this leads to your cellular death. So this is used for treatment of moderate antiprotozoal agent. Okay, this is the mechanism of action, because they selectively inhibit the mitochondrial energy electron transport mechanism, which is very important as a source of ATP, which is necessary for the protozoal agents. So if that energy is blocked, this leads to your cell death. This leads to your cell. Example, atovaquinone. The structure is naphthoquinone along with connected to a cyclohexyl and a chlorobenzene moiety. So next is pentamidine. Pentamidine. So what is this pentamidine? If you can see the structure, structure is very simple. It contains a gonadine linkage. It contains a gonadine linkage attached to your phenolic group at the fourth position. So what is the basic thing it contains? If you see the structure is a symmetrical structure. So it contains a phenolic group, which is connected to an amidine linkage. As I said, NH2C double bond N is known as amidine linkage. Okay, it is known as amidine linkage. Okay, and this phenolic group, it is connected by CH2-5 to a similar group, that is phenolic. This is connected by CH2 methylene group 5 times to another phenolic group similar containing an amidine. So this is the structure of pentamidine. So they inhibit your DNA and RNA synthesis. They bind and aggregates with your ribosome. So your mRNA, which is responsible for protein synthesis, they bind with the ribosome, and this leads to your death. This is basically they use for the treatment of pneumocystis jerivoci, and also mean for treatment of other pneumocystis pneumonia tripo treatment. Okay, then also other use also used for in protozoal infection. The side effects are bronchospasm, leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, and acute pancreatitis. So these are the side effects: renal failure, increased liver function studies, hypotension, and many other side effects are associated with this particular drug. That is pentamidine. So what does it? It contains an amidine linkage, that is NH2C double bond, and connected to a phenolic group at the fourth position, and which is connected to another similar group by a CH2-5 group. Okay. That is the structure of your pentamidine. Okay, so let's go for the next. So antibiotics. So which are the antibiotics? So what is the? They are the secondary function. They have got the secondary function. They act as a backup for this antimetabolite. So they are in combination with your antiprotozoal drug or antiamoebic drug. So what is basically this antibiotics like tetracycline, clotetracycline, erythromycin, paromycin? So they are just a cleansing agent. They act as a cleansing agent. So what they do, they are given in combination with other action. They don't have a direct action, but they kill, they destroy the enteric bacteria necessary for your amoebic proliferation. As I said in your previous earlier, that they depend on the bacteria which is present inside the gut for their proliferation. So what does this antibiotics do? They will kill the bacteria which are present in your intestine. So when this will starve them to death. This is another example of starving to death. So they will not get the bacteria which is necessary for their growth. So thus they will starve them to death. This is the mechanism of action of your antibiotics. So paramycin is an example of this antibiotic directly affect in the lumen. They also interfere with the protozoal DNA and RNA synthesis. They also have some effect on, they may inhibit the DNA and RNA by inhibiting the 50S ribosomal subunits, by interacting with the 50S ribosomal subunit. Adverse effects are diarrhea, anorexia, and loss of appetite. So these are the drugs of choice. So in case of asymptomatic cyst carriers, so what is the combination of drug, what is the drug used? It is basically iodoquinone, paromycin, or diloxin. So in case of diarrhea, dysentery, or extra-intestinal, metronidazole plus iodoquinone or paromycin or diloxin. So this combination can be used. If there is an amoebic liver abscess, chloroquine plus metronidazole or emetine. So these drugs are the choice. So these are some of the drugs. What is the specific, where does it go, and what is the mechanism of action? So this chart explains how the specific drug acts and what is the mechanism of action. That in case of bentamide, they affect the synthesis of structural nucleic acid. Okay, specifics at where they act, they bind with the ketonoplast of the DNA, they inhibit the DNA replication as in case of metronidazole. Sumarin, they bind to the plasma protein that inhibit the glucose utilization. Iodoquinoline steadily liberates iodine, which mode of action is they inhibit the sulfatidyl group. Disulfide also they inhibit the sulfatidyl. Inhibits that efluorethine, they bind with the ornithine decarboxylase, which inhibit your polyamine synthesis and thus affects the cell division and proliferation. So these are the various sites of action and drugs where they act. Okay. These are some of the drugs. Same thing, the combinations which are used. Okay. This completes your anti-protozoal